I've had the great pleasure of this morning having Nick Bundy in with us. We've just looked at your brand new looking toolkit that you've managed to get hold of, and we've looked at your testing kit, and now we're going to open the questions up to the learners that are giving up, in most of the cases, Nick, their day off to actually come in and see you. So I thought to think you must be a little bit impressed with that. So give Nick another round of applause. Okay, so we're going to go for some open questions from the audience, so we don't know what we're going to get. That's always a little bit worrying. So hands up then if you've got a question for me. Lewis, what's your question?
How long have you been self-employed for?
So how long have you been self-employed for?
I left college, I left school 2008, so started college straight away, 3 years. So what are we on now, 2020? So I think nine, 10 years now.
Because you pretty much went from college to working for yourself. Because was it your dad?
Right.
So they won't have listened to it. Fill them in on the story.
Granddad was a carpenter. I thought I would want to be a carpenter. So trained with that. My dad was a self-employed paint decorator. He wanted me to carry on his business, but unfortunately for him, I had more about me than painting things. That's fine. So I went into college to be a carpenter originally, and he looked at my grades and turned around and went, you know, you've got some good stuff about you, why don't you try electrics? And dad being in the trade, he was like, oh yeah, you know, definitely try electrics. And that was it. That's how I got sort of pushed into the general direction of electrics.
But you were doing a full-time course? You weren't at that stage actually employed?
And no,
did you not move from the day course? Were you not the...
I did level one and level two straight away. Full-time course, even though it was 3.5 days a week or something, while working at Tesco to sort of finance my car and all that sort of stuff. Then I actually managed to get a job on a main build. I was doing with a few domestic electricians on my days off as well, so for free, for a year and a half, learning the trade, very much like Adam's doing with me, picking up the practical skills. And then from that, I got a job subcontracting to a big firm in Stafford, where I live, doing the big council buildings, and I had to get self-employed to do that, to subcontract. So that's sort of the stage it went through for that. Once that was up and over, after a year, I became qualified from level three as the job ended. They offered me a job to go and start doing stuff with them in London or wherever, and I was just like, no, I'm all right. At that stage in my life, I was happy where I was. My mum and dad, you know, paid for everything and whatnot. So, yeah, my dad sort of turned around and went, you know, you've got no overheads, you just pay for your own phone contract, go self-employed. You know, get buy a van, try it. So that was it, and I've never looked back since.
So pretty much, you've only ever been employed by yourself? Pretty much.
Yeah, no one's told me what to do for several years, which is the way I like it.
Okay. Fantastic question. And I think that's a fantastic answer. So next one, let's have another question from the audience over here.
If you weren't an electrician, what would you be?
Oh, yeah. So if you... Well, let me go first.
Yeah, go on.
Obviously, male model, you'd like to say, boy band. Love Island probably came a little... Well, I don't know.
Unfortunately, I've been in a relationship with children, so I don't think she'd take... I mean, she'd probably like prize money, so... But no.
So you're suggesting you'd win it anyhow, is that what you said? So if you want to
look, got a dab a few times, don't I?
Yeah, okay. And with that in mind, you've actually quite quickly built a family up as well as a business, haven't you?
Yeah, so I've been with a half for, Christ, I hope she doesn't watch this, six years.
Okay. And in that time, so you must have one child in that time?
Yes, well, three actually. The eldest isn't mine, and I've got two kids, a boy and a girl, and bought a house, did all the malarkey, engaged, no marriage yet. That's a bit of a waste of money.
Breaking news. We always like a breaking news story. So is that going to happen this evening, the proposal for marriage?
No, we are engaged. Yeah, already done that. It's sort of planning a wedding of some sort. But she's in the same boat as me, which is nice.
Always class a proposal with a date. So you've bought her a piece of jewellery. You're not getting married, you just bought her a piece of jewellery.
Bought a piece of jewellery, yeah, in the process of sorting a wedding out. But to me and her, it's... You've got kids together. You can't be more binding than that. And it's just, it'll happen when it happens.
Okay. So back to the original question.
To be fair, I'm sort of waiting for Adam to be old enough to go on the stag do. So.
Oh, wow.
Another year or so, that's it.
Well, to organise it, really. Yeah. You know, just take the pressure off. So the original question was, so you obviously chose to be an electrician. You had a couple of other choices there. We had carpentry in the background and we had painting and decorating. With hindsight now, so go back and pick yourself something that maybe you would have liked to have had the challenge of if you were an electrician.
A police officer, I think. Yeah. I sort of always liked it. One of my best friends was a fireman. He's now a paramedic. I always liked it. I grew up, one of my neighbours was a police officer. And kids, you sort of think you like, but I just always seemed to like it. And even now, I've over the years where you go up and down throughout business, it was never plain sailing like it is now. I've built something up and it's sustainable and it's enjoyable. Yep. You go through your rough patches of being self-employed. And there was a few times I've looked into it and gone, you know, maybe it's time for a change. But that was just my age, immaturity, not going to work properly, you know, the usual teenager slash young adult stage of not putting 100% into it.
Are you out of that stage yet? Because you look just about remarkably fresh.
I know.
Is having Adam with you in the van aged you? Because all of a sudden then you feel like a little bit.
Grown up. Yeah, because we've gone a few times. When we went to the Elect show and I put Green Day on in the van, I thought, right, classic bit of Green Day. You lot, probably half of you, have never even heard of it. He was like, what's Green Day? And I've never punched someone so hard while I was driving. And then we went through loads of different bands, you know, Sum 41, all the stuff that I grew up with and listened to. And he was like, no, never heard of it. And I was like, sat there, thought, oh my God, I've taken the mick out of people for so many years of their age. And now I've come to the stage where he can take the mick out of me for it. And it's just, it was heartbreaking. But, it is what it is.
So you've been to an Elect show. Have you ever been to an eFIXX live feed event?
I have indeed.
Did you happen to be the fastest electrician in the room at that event?
Yes.
Did you win yourself some nice ceiling mounted speakers at that event?
Yes.
Have you fitted those speakers?
I fitted the one. One of them is in my dining room. The kids love it. Peppa Pig gets played through quite a bit. But yeah, bathroom one's yet to go in. But yeah, great night. You, Joe, Adam went along. Adam won a few bits.
What did Adam win?
Won the... Is it Google Home or Echo? No, the Dot.
Yeah.
That was it.
Is it Google Dot? I always get mixed up. Is it
Google
Dot? Is it Echo Dot?
I don't know.
Okay, he won something as well. So yeah, you cleaned up, didn't you, when you were at the event?
It wasn't fixed at all.
No, I couldn't fix the race. I mean, you were the fastest one. I might have told Adam where to sit. Maybe I encouraged him to sit in a certain seat. So it's good. So, you know, in hindsight, it's quite ironic because I actually wanted to be a policeman. And my dad said to me, you couldn't go into the police force until you were 18. So he said, get yourself a trade. And then when you come out of your trade, make the decision then when you wanted to go into the police force.
Yeah.
So that was, it was different back in my day. Let's do that because you didn't have to have such now. You need a degree almost to be a police officer.
Yes.
And you have to do the specials first. In my day, you could almost go in with
with a this is what I looked into it. And it wasn't a simple, I had good grades. You know, don't get me wrong. I didn't enjoy school at all. I just, it was the whole process of people telling you what to do. And I've always really struggled. I've always, you know, good pupil, got good grades, you know, was always well behaved. It's just, there's always a thing in the back of my head, I just hated being told what to do. So when I got sort of the stage where I could come become self-employed, watching my dad for years being self-employed, no one telling him what to do, and he could come home, middle of the day, have his lunch, do whatever he wants,
I'll just stop you there, because anyone who's self-employed does none of that. Doesn't come over in the middle of the day. Probably doesn't have lunch. Probably works.
He's
through,
a painter. Was a painter.
Do you take those options?
No, not at all. I have the same thing where it's different now. We've been working for myself and by myself for several years, and then Adam's come along. I sort of have to look at the clock and go, "Are you hungry? Do we need to stop for some lunch?" Because I won't. Most of the time, I don't eat during the day. The quicker I get the work done, the quicker I go home. In my eyes, sometimes it doesn't work that way, but sometimes you need to eat because you end up slacking and make mistakes towards the end of the day. So,
And you probably do more in that. So if you have a later lunch, because always find you do way more work until 2 o'clock.
Yeah.
And then from half two till 5 o'clock, you probably do next thing, I think. Yeah. An hour in the morning's worth two at night. Is that the
That's
phrase?
It, yeah. I mean, we've worked quite late. Adam had about 9 o'clock. Sometimes I had to text his mum, make sure it's all right. I've got him a speed dial.
Give her three rings.
But. Yeah, so I enjoy working late at night, and he's sound with it. I don't mind at all. I prefer working later in the evening than finishing at 3 o'clock, and I don't know. You end up just sitting around for a while. Obviously, I've got kids, so you sort the kids out and whatnot. But there's something in satisfaction I find sometimes leaving in the morning when it's dark and coming home when it's dark. Obviously, that's all the time at the moment. But.
Yeah. Okay. That's good. Great question. Good answer. Nick, give us another question, please. So as I look around to the audience, I've got loads. So if we have to come to a Gary question down here.
Do you like it better being self-employed than employed?
Yeah, 100%.
So we can confirm that it's absolutely going to be the self-employed. So you decided less than 12 months ago, if I got my maths right, to join that world of YouTube.
Yeah.
Okay, so you thought you'd throw your hat into quite a busy ring now, I would suggest. To stand out in that crowd takes a while. Some people have tried and not been successful. You look like you've completely crushed it, because I think we've just gone through 10,000 subs. You gave away some kit for that. So we're probably aiming to be 12,000 in a hurry.
Yeah, not far off 11 at the moment, soon to be 12. It's sort of averaging 12.
And will that be in less than a year? Has your year point come yet?
No, right. So it sort of worked out really well. My first video that was released 8th of May last year was actually the anniversary of my dad's death. So it just sounded quite morbid, but it's something that's easily rememberable, if you know what I mean. So it's not even a year yet. So hopefully, you know, if I can get up to 12, fantastic. But the rate it's going, 13 maybe, possibly. Depends if I keep putting them out there. I went through a stage of trying to put two videos out a week because the jobs allowed me, because I had Adam with me. It was simple to do the right type of jobs. It started getting to a few stages where I felt like some videos were being put out for the sake of putting a video out,
right, okay,
rather than actual good content. And somewhere I try and do a video, each video, so someone can learn from, like you guys can watch it, or other sparks to watch it and go, oh, like the way you did, that's a bit different from mine, I can try that, because that's what I picked up from watching the other guys to start with. So yeah,
With that in mind, I keep seeing a photograph in the background on some of your videos, and that photograph is a Dan from DSS.
Yes.
Explain the story behind that then.
Well, out of nowhere one day, I remember I was driving back and I listened to music, someone rang me, and I did cut the phone off because I really like that song, to be honest. I can't remember what it was.
Green Day.
It wasn't Green Day, no. I can't remember for life me what it was. And I didn't recognise the number, and I thought, if they need me, I'll leave a message, I'll ring them when I get back. And I pulled up at the job and something just looked at me, the phone number, and I was like, oh, I'll ring them back, and answer the phone. Hi Nick, it's Dan from DSS. And I was like, oh my God, why are you ringing me? It was like, oh, I watch your stuff on YouTube. And I'd only been doing it 2 months, 3 months. And I've still never met him. But we speak like most weeks on the phone or WhatsApp or just general chit chat about everything, help with work, talk about YouTube. Because he said the same thing with me, is it's nice to have someone that's involved with YouTube because they get it. They understand the analytics, the statistics, putting stuff out, the comments, you know, the haters. But when I'm sat trying to talk to my other half at home about it, and she's just there like, yep. It's like, oh, crap. It's like talking to a wall. But then someone else that does it that you can bounce off and understand what they're getting on about. It's nice. It is nice.
I know you spoke to him a lot. He's a lovely bloke.
He is.
They've all been great to come in, but it's just something about Dan. He's just a super lovely guy. And he's coming back. He's going to come back and see us in March. He's coming on a Wednesday, so we get Dan coming back. We're going to squeeze Artisan Electrical in between. He's desperate to come in, and we're desperate to see Jordan as well.
Good old Jordan. Do you want to leave my Hoover here for him?
Well, yeah. I like the, what was it called? I'm not good with technology. Well, you're both on the screen talking at the same time.
Oh, the Skype, yeah.
Skyping, that's it.
See, that was, it had every intention of being good, but because it was the audio, my Mac with my microphone, we didn't do a test run to start with to see it was his volume coming through and then coming back through my mic.
Right.
And it was painful to listen to. Like,
that's good.
No, the content was good. Yeah, it was just the audio was terrible.
Yeah. And with that in mind, podcasts floating around and all the rest of it, is that something, a world of podcasts that you might want to venture into in the future? Because I think you've got a good repertoire.
I speak to Sam on a regular basis from me, and Rick from Electrician's Guide to Everything.
Yeah.
And I really enjoyed it, but we'll all find this from anyone you listen to that's first time on there, you get the podcast shyness of, you talk for a little bit before and then you start recording and you sort of like crawl up a little bit and you don't, I don't know why, even I did it, and then towards the end of the podcast you open up and it's fine. But to go back on again and do it second time around and try it. But yeah, I'm all open to it. I enjoy it, and it's just like you say, putting things out there. Before I even started doing this, I was just by myself, lad from a little village in Stafford, and as soon as you put stuff on YouTube, like the world's just opened. Like it has, the world's just, there's a whole world's opened up that you don't even know existing until you're here.
No.
With companies messaging you, like this especially, come and meet you guys.
Yeah.
I'm very grateful for it all, to be honest.
And we're in the same position here at Tresham. When Joe came and joined me to help me out, dig me out of a hole, we got to about video 164 and we got something free. You know, someone sent us something, it cost 15 quid. Well, we were walking around for about 3 weeks, 8'6". We got some free stuff. It's quite nice to get recognised, isn't it? I don't mean recognised in the street, I mean, but recognised for the effort you're putting in for the industry.
Yeah.
And that's what it's all about. And apart from haters, obviously the content that's out there should be raising the profile of the industry and raising standards and people's expectations of what an electrician will do for them, perhaps more than empowering the DIY market.
I had a few comments originally from people around my area who said, oh, it's what you're doing here isn't a good thing because old Bill and Ben from around the corner that wants to DIY their stuff, they can copy your video. I was like, well, if they're stupid enough to do that, then that's up to them. I mean, you've got to put a thing on, do not copy this video, it's not how to, because it's not how to.
No.
I never once in my videos ever will I say, this is how you do it. I always say, this is how I do it, because I'm a trained, qualified, competent electrician.
Yeah.
And they're not. So it's one of them things of, you'll always get people that think you're wrong, or people think you're right, so. Yeah.
That's good.
So, but not just that's in anything.
Yeah, you know. Yeah, absolutely. So the ambition for the channel, let's see if we can go through 12,000 within 12 months.
I'd love that, yeah.
We're totally chuffed a bit to an electrician. And we'll end on the last one. What's the chances of Adam becoming your full apprentice by academic year September 20? Is that something that's going to happen?
100%.
Okay, yeah. So
Adam's proved himself through and through.
He's had the longest trial known to man, though.
He has had the longest trial. Unfortunately, we missed out on the apprenticeship this time round. Otherwise, he'd be starting halfway through and miss out some stuff. So we spoke to the college, and it's going to be starting in September. He's done exactly what I did. I've said this in a few videos before. I went out there, I messaged people to get a job for free. I didn't get paid. I bought my got tools bought for me for Christmas and birthdays and everything like that for as long as I could, and eventually it paid off. And Adam's dad, obviously I've known him since he was little, approached me and said, this is what we want to do. I said, yeah, no problem. So we had a little trial. He was great. Then it came to the stage of, right, what do you want me? No, I don't want any money, Nick. I want to do this. I want to get, you know, experience on site. I'll start college in September and then we'll sort of have a chat. And it's just led and led further and further. He's been able to grow my business, which has then enabled me to go, yeah, I can take you on and I can pay you, you know, in the new academic year. So, yeah.
That's really good. So you're actually, so in a day's work, you've actually been booking fractionally more because he's actually become, yeah. So I don't like the word useful because I've met him a few times now and you can tell he's useful. But actually you can say to yourself, well, we can actually get further into a job, yeah, because Adam's, yeah, been helping, so he's paying for himself.
Exactly. So like even the other day, the fuse board one we did, I did the fuse board outside. Adam's going around, changing the faceplates, lights, everything inside. It would have been a 2-day job for me.
Right.
But with me doing the fuse board, and we nipped over a couple of hours at the end of the day, which allowed us to then get it completed within a day. Because normally it's very difficult to do a fuse board change in a day, full testing, your bonding, all that sort of stuff. To do it properly, you would want to come back for a couple of hours the next day. It allowed me to get it all finished off and Adam do the rest of it. So, yeah.
That's good. That's all round good. Thank you very much for that.